Hello, Ben.
Hello.
Good to see you.
Hello.
How are you today?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm great. Yeah. How are you?
Good, good. And you know, I'm asking every speaker, and my co-host also asking our speakers the same question, and we want you to answer it as well. So what was the first game you created?
First game I created was probably typing something out from one of the old Atari magazines. You used to get printouts of code in paper form. And so you were literally just copy pasting by hand. And it was like a move the boat along a canal kind of game. Game in a very loose sense, but like, yeah, literally just like typing stuff out. So yeah, even so many years later, now I'm copy pasting from Stack Overflow, but originally it was from paper. So there you go.
Yeah, I can relate, but mine's a bit older with the BBC, you know, and the Spectrum. It's copying and typing out lots and lots of code.
Okay.
By the way, Ben, I don't know how long have you been awake, but have you heard one of the questions from the Waffle? Like, OG version of Unreal Editor 1, which UI framework it used to make the UI?
Slate? Probably not. It's probably before then.
No. So I think it came like in the third edition of Unreal, but the very first Unreal Editor was made with Visual Basic.
Oh, wow. Okay, I didn't know that. History is not as good as... Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, that was a great question. Actually, yeah, so we're going to talk about UI and C++, which sometimes make me like, wow, what do you actually use to do UI and C++? Because many people, if they answer something, they usually say maybe cute, like that they all, mm-hmm. That's all they know. Hopefully, like yeah, in game development, we have more options. So let's discuss how we can do UI and C++. So Ben, the stage is yours. So please
great.
Start.
Thanks very much. Yeah. So today we're going to be talking about UI, how to make UI with using C++. And so, yeah, in Unreal, we don't use Qt or Qt. We use something else called Slate, NUMG. So today we're going to be talking about that. And the alternative title for this was How I Stopped Being Terrified of Slate, because Slate in Unreal has a little bit of a reputation of being kind of weird. It looks very odd. It's not really what you're used to in other kind of standard C++ stuff, but hopefully with this, you should be able to look at it and not run away screaming. So before we get there, let's talk about, did it not change? Oh, there we go. Let me click here. There we go. So first, a little bit about who I am. So my name is Ben. I'm a UI programmer for... I'm a UI programmer at Brace Yourself Games, and I'm working on Industries of Titan previously, and now I'm working on a new project. So I've also made a lot of Unreal tutorials that I post on my website at Ben UI. So what are we going to talk about today? So first we'll do like a little rough overview of what Unreal's UI tech is. So if you're not super familiar with it, hopefully you should be able to get something out of this talk. And then we're going to make a Slate widget from scratch. So just hopefully starting without any boilerplate and explaining what each bit does. We'll do a couple more advanced examples with Slate, and then we'll kind of wrap it up in UMG so it's a bit more modern and user-friendly. And then we'll hopefully have a little bit of time at the end for questions. So Unreal, it's what do we have in there? So Slate and UMG are the main sort of core bits of tech, but what are they? So basically everything in Unreal uses Slate by default. You could use a third party. There are third party apps that let you make things, the third party frameworks that let you make things using HTML5 and other things, but Slate is what the editor is built in. So basically all of this you see is written using Slate. And all of this is technically Slate under the hood. And even Fortnite is Slate under the hood. It might be UMG, but we'll see that it is actually Slate under the hood. So what is Slate? Slate is just a C++ library, and it helps make user interfaces easier. So Slate looks like this. This might be what you're used to seeing if you think about Slate, is this kind of odd syntax with open square brackets and pluses. It's a little bit odd, but we'll go into more of that later. It's also got a lot of macros. So this slate underscore declare widget and slate underscore begin args, these are macros that you can use to kind of define your declare your slate class. Okay, so if that's Slate, what's UMG? So Slate was made way before UMG and Unreal and UMG and blueprints were a thing. And so it doesn't really know about blueprints. UMG was made to be a layer between or a bridge between Slate and blueprints. So blueprints can talk to Slate. In practice, that looks something like this. So this is a button, a UMG button. This hopefully some of this should look a little bit more familiar than the Slate. So there's the kind of UObject style macros that you might be used to seeing, like UClass and generated body. There's also UProperties, so blueprints can access those. But under the hood, it's actually wrapping a Slate button. So all the widgets you're kind of used to using if you've played with Unreal's UMG system are like, you know, vertical boxes and buttons and images. Those all wrap Slate parallels. And the naming convention is usually identical. So U button is the UMG button, and S button is the Slate button. So U text block wraps S text block. And so if you make your own, generally you want to call it, you know, U something wraps S something. So that's what we're going to be doing today. So that's kind of the overview. So we're going to hopefully, if I go back a slide, we're going to make the S thing first, and then we're going to make the U thing at the end. Okay, so let's start making a Slate widget from scratch. The project source for this should be available online already. If it's not, it will be up by the end of the presentation. If you're using Rider, you can create a new widget using the kind of like add class wizard. Just select Slate widget and call it something without the S because it automatically adds the S at the front. So before we get into actually like typing and, you know, well, writing and looking at the code, there's actually a couple of different options of what you can subclass. By default, it will subclass S compound widget, but it's kind of good to know what different classes there are, or like base classes there are in Slate. There's leaf widgets, which don't have any children. So those will be things like images and text blocks. There's panels, which are kind of like very generic, venue, like multi-purpose things like overlays and horizontal boxes that are designed to support kind of up to any number of children. And then there's kind of everything else, which you would probably put in compound widget. So if you're making a new custom widget, you probably want it to be a child of S compound widget. And that includes things like buttons and borders that have one child, or imagine you were creating a new sort of tooltip panel widget that had a title and a body, that had like two children, then you could, you'd probably want to inherit from S compound widget. Okay. So when we've run our wizard, this is what comes out. It's kind of the bare bones of what you can have with a Slate widget. We're going to cover more about what these macros kind of become just after, but first we want to get something up on screen. But it's kind of good to kind of note what this, what the base level looks like. So you have Slate begin args, the name of our widget class, and then open and close curly braces, which is kind of weird there, and then end args. And then we have a construct function, which isn't virtual or override. So that's kind of odd. Yeah, there we go. Highlight those in the construct function. Okay, and then the CPP for this is, oops, let's go back. The CPP for this is just a construct function. What we're doing here is child slot. Well, we won't go into too deep depth right now, but we will later on. What we're doing here is we're creating a new text block with SNew. And then we're going to set the text using like our localized text stuff here. Child slot is like a specific, a thing specific to S compound widget. So you can kind of set what the interior of that widget will look like. Okay, and then let's add it to the screen. So I usually put all of my kind of UI, what do you call it? Like overriding the UI central code in HUD subclass. So in this case, my BUI HUD subclass has a shared pointer to this example widget. And we create an instance of that there and add it to the screen using add viewpoint widget content. And then, right, that's what it looks like when it's actually up on screen. So that's getting a slate widget, like the bare bones of it, from writing it in C++ to adding it to the screen. It's not as painful as it seems, I hope. So let's go back and add some more arguments to our new widget and then look into what the macros are actually doing. So if we add a new argument to our widget, in this case, some text, this means that we could set the text for each instance of our example widget. I guess this could be like, it's a label. We could say this is a special kind of label that maybe we add some extra functionality later. So we add that with slate argument here. What that does is when we create our instance of it, we can, previously we would set text with just a static piece of text, so hello world. Now we have a new member variable within this f arguments called underscore label text. So it's kind of interesting. When we set it back here, we said, okay, we want an argument of type f text with the name label text. But then here we get f arguments comes in with a member variable underscore label text. And then when we actually create an instance of our S example widget, we can call a function which has been automatically created for us called label text. So instead of setting the text inside the construct, we're now setting it when we create an instance of our S example widget. So that seems a bit weird. Let's try and dive into what is actually happening in this macro gunk. I think it helps to understand that it's not complete voodoo. It does do stuff. Let's start with begin args and end args. So it's a macro. It is kind of hard to read write this like this. So let's clean up that and, you know, get rid of all the new lines and so that the text highlighter can actually show us what it is. So all it's doing here is creating a new local struct called f-arguments with a constructor, an empty constructor. And then end args is literally just like close curly parentheses and semicolon. Okay, so one other thing, we'll just dive slightly deeper. And what is this slate base named args thing? What it's doing is it's defining a bunch of kind of default attributes that every widget has, the tooltip text, some is it enabled, what's its visibility. If you've messed around with widgets at all, then you'll see a lot of these things actually exist still in UMG. So the visibility is there, the render opacity. These are things that you've probably seen. Okay, that's probably a little bit too deep for the start, but basically the macros expand from that slate begin args, slate end args to creating a local struct. What about these arguments then? So in our case, we had label text. So in this case, it actually expands to make a local variable within the struct and also a function with the same name. So what we're actually doing here is we're making a local struct called, I'll show it in a second, called f-args, and then we're setting, like adding some local member variables and setting some functions for that. Okay. Yeah, this is basically just expanding the macros. So you have a local member variable and setting that. So that's why when you use the in-args thing, you can get the member variables. Okay. So we'll go on something a bit more, less about the constructor and a bit more about like some of the features of slate. So when you are writing a lot of slate, you'll see a lot of these open and close square brackets and plus. So in this case, what is happening here? So we've got a horizontal box and we're adding a slot and then we are putting something inside. Like visually, it kind of makes sense, but what's going on? So slate and UMG, I mean, UMG is based on top of Slate, so if Slate has it, then UMG has it. They have the concept of slots. So a slot is basically a way that containers will control the layout of their children. So if you have a horizontal box, you might want to say these particular parts should fill, and these other pieces should only take up the minimum amount of space. The formatting's a bit messed up there. It basically say, how would you make this? This is a small button, very small button, with a small image there. So if you were going to do that in widget using blueprints, you would probably just make a hierarchy like this, where you have a horizontal box, an image, and then a size box that contains a button. And you might say that, oh, I want my size box to be at least 200 pixels wide, and I want the size box to fill the most of the horizontal box, and the image to just take up the size it needs. So that's what it would look like in the hierarchy. So how would we translate that into Slate? So starting off, we have our child slot, just like our previous example. That's kind of like our base, our root widget that we start with. First, we would create a horizontal box, which is kind of what we saw in the hierarchy. Then we're adding a new slot, so it's like a new container to put something. We're gonna customize it so it only takes up the amount of space required, that's auto width, and we'll set the padding to something small. Then inside there, we create a new widget, that's new. Then our second slot, we want it to fill the entire remaining space and have a bigger padding. Within there, we put a box with minimum size, and within there, we put a button. So breaking it down, it's not too painful, I hope. And then it creates that. Okay, so now let's have another example where we want to build a widget iteratively. So in this case, imagine you wanted a big list of buttons. So previously, we've done everything in a kind of a declarative style where we just write out everything our widget will contain. But how would we be able to have a variable number of buttons? So we can't do S new depending on the number of buttons in this style. So what we can do is we can use S assign new and save a pointer to the vertical box that we want to add the buttons to. So this is the syntax for it. You would have a t-shared pointer to the thing you want to keep, and then S assign new as the variable first and then the variable type. So coming up with another minimal-ish example, we have our shared pointer to a list box. We've also got some arguments there for the number of buttons, but that's kind of the same as our previous examples. So in here, when we create our widget, the first thing we do is we save out the vertical box to a variable, list box. And then we're going to rebuild from data every time that the number changes. So every time that we change the number of buttons we need, we'll refill the list box. So we clear the children and then iteratively go through calling add slot. So add slot is kind of like the same thing when you call plus in your declarative style. This one is in a more iterative style. And so yeah, that's what you end up with at the end. So that's enough Slate for now. Let's see how we can wrap the Slate with UMG. The reason you would want to do this is because, well, UMG is a bridge between Slate and Blueprints. So if you ever want Blueprints to be able to control the Slate, or you want to be able to kind of edit the variables from within the editor, you're going to need to create a UMG wrapper for your Slate widget. So this is back to our original example of just a widget that has a text label. So the base kind of, minimal widget, UMG widget, is this. The main thing you care about in this case is rebuild widget. So if you notice here, we do have a shared pointer to our example widget. And we do have like a local copy of the text we want to set in there. So when that gets changed, we will rebuild the widget, which is kind of like creating the Slate widget again from scratch and setting its variables. So this is what the body of the function would look like. When you rebuild it, you just create a widget using sNew and set its text using label text. So that's that function that was created when we added the slate attribute to our kind of constructor. And you have to make sure to also release the slate resources, otherwise you get a crash. So now to actually see it in game, you can add it to the screen just as a vanilla UMG widget, but it also means that we can add it to user widget blueprints, which is kind of like my preferred methodology for this. So it's now it's listed in our uncategorized palette on the left near the top. We can drag and drop it into our widget. So you see example widget there. And then when you select it, there's example text shown in the top right. And that's just the U property that we put there. If we wanted to change every time we edit the sample text, instead of having to hit compile every time, then we could override synchronize properties to do that. If you look in the example on the GitHub, then you should be able to see how to do that. So here's the C++ for how to spawn that user widget blueprint. I like putting everything in HUD subclass. So here you would have a soft class pointer to the user widget. You could just do a T subclass of, but then you're kind of like, you're going to end up loading the blueprint itself every time your HUD gets loaded. And then you just call create widget to and add it to viewport. This is kind of like a more of a standard workflow for creating blueprint user widgets. So you might be more used to this. Okay, so that's kind of the general overview of how you make a slate widget and some more complicated ones and then wrap it in UMG so you can show it on screen. Just for like a final little bit of more discussion on like when would you want to do each one? So why would you want to use slate? Why would you want to use UMG? Why would you want to use user widgets? So user widgets on their own, you would probably want to use those most of the time. I do most of my work using that. It lets you create the layout using a visual editor, which is a lot more natural for a lot of people. If you're just using a bunch of standard widgets, then there's no need to create anything from slate necessarily. You could create, if you're working with editor code, then you would need to move into slate. But you would probably just be using standard widgets for that. So if you're doing game dev and the reason you would go into slate and create a new custom widget is if the standard widgets don't have the features that you need. So those might be for performance reasons or for if you're doing some really complicated layout. I could imagine that's why you might want to do it. But a lot of the time you can kind of get everything you need out of user widgets. It's just for editor stuff and for performance that you jump down into slate. For more references on how to create custom slate widgets, then I'd check out the Lyra Starter Game project. Your Lighthouse has a really amazing like slate compendium, which is just a huge document full of all the information you would need about UMG and slate. And Alessa has some really good slate resources as well, like a list of editor plugins with really good examples. I think the best way to learn this stuff is to look at examples. So dig into the editor, see how they've implemented stuff. You can use the widget reflector to select widgets and then see how they're declared in C++. So yeah, thanks for listening. That's pretty much it. We should have time for questions at the end if anybody has any questions.
Yeah, thank you, Ben. Thank you. That was actually a great talk and I enjoyed it a lot, even though I was really a little bit confused because I was sitting and thinking about, oh, I see macros again. Okay, so we're in C++. Unreal Engine is macros. Slate is macros. So yeah. What's going on macros there in the world? Can we use something
always
better?
With macros.
Yep.
Yeah, but I mean, like, seriously, do you know if there is any opportunity for us to do better?
It's what everything is built on. It's the stuff that everything is on in Unreal. I don't know if that will ever go away.
Macros in the essence of everything, unfortunately or fortunately, I don't know. Okay.
Give me two cents about the macro thingy. And I'm pissed that I'm not getting into the Unreal C++ talk, being Unreal dude in the JetBrains. All right. So currently, with the introduction of the tuple arguments, I've seen in the last versions of Unreal, they are like slowly migrating from some macros to C++. So for example, for declared delegates, as well, there's the proper C++ implementation that looks much nicer even than the macros itself. And I mean, that's much nicer to use one. I don't know for myself if there's any plans to add it to Slate, because I'm not sure that the macros in the Slate are more for the Unreal header tool, or are they are actual C++ macros that actually evaluate to something. I need to dig that up in for myself.
I don't know myself. Yeah, from what I see, it does seem like they're just regular macros, but I'm still relatively new to this stuff, I guess. Yeah.
So I was going to ask, as the example you gave at the start was Fortnite as using its UI, and obviously the UI there is heavily custom. Can you go from what you've shown into those custom UIs?
Yeah.
And how does that work?
Have an example. So if I go back to the start, can I click here? Nope. Okay, let me go all the way back to the start. Okay, everything's Slate. Yeah, so I think in this case, you would probably want to be using Slate for performance reasons more than custom layout. But a lot of this, you could technically do it all in blueprints right now. Like all of the kind of pop-out boxes with the exclamation marks, all of this could really be done. If you had some very complicated layering stuff, you would probably want to do that in materials. To be honest, Slate is mostly used for editor things. I've seen people use it for kind of mini maps and custom stuff like that, where things are not necessarily, you know, perfectly on a grid or aligned, and you have lots of widgets kind of moving around. I'd probably use it for that. And then also, I mean, it's just for performance reasons. Like if you're spawning a particular widget, hundreds and hundreds of times, if you can avoid using UObjects for that, and you can go straight into Slate and just do it that way, you're saving a huge amount of overhead on memory and spinning things up. If you've already tried using like pooling widgets and other solutions, probably I'd do that first. And then if that's still too much overhead, or you're targeting a particularly resource poor platform, then maybe you'd want to start doing things in Slate.
Okay, so because I'm not familiar with the with Slate in this way at all, what would be the widgets on that screen there then, or have I got that wrong?
No, yeah, you could probably guess some of these. I mean, this I don't know if you can see my mouse, mm-hmm. but like across the top here, that could be just a horizontal box with a bunch of buttons inside. Okay. I can probably speak better to my own UI rather than saying all the wrong stuff about Fortnite, because sure. I'm sure the actual developers will be like, yeah, no, that's not how we did it at all. in my case, like across the top here, when you've got those speed indicators right at the top, that's just a horizontal box with four buttons in it. And the buttons have a state for like, are they selected or not? On the left here, it's just an overlay. And then inside there, it's a lot of overlays within overlays with padding and stuff. Here you've got a scroll box and a bunch of text elements, like rich text elements, so we can format parts within there. So like these kind of, where it says employees there, you can tooltip over that and show things. Let's see. You end up with sort of fancy things like drag and drop elements down here that you could drag and drop these. I'm trying to think what other stuff there is there. I mean, most of it is just buttons and horizontal boxes and vertical boxes. I try and use those over canvases. Canvases let you kind of set the positioning more specifically, but a lot of the time I do okay with just overlays and horizontal boxes and padding and stuff. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Would you say then this is better suited to a more sort of head-up display kind of UI?
You could. I mean, if you weren't going for something super complicated and you were making something that's a bit more static without huge amounts of kind of changing data, then yeah, Slate would probably work well for that. You would probably minimize some of your overhead a little bit. But again, it would slow down iteration time. It stops, if you write everything in Slate, then artists or UI artists or UI designers can't come in and move things around easily. They are forced to talk to a UI programmer to mess with stuff in C++. I mean, that's why, I guess that's why UMG was made, like UMG and Blueprints. It lets less, yeah, it doesn't, you don't, you know, bottleneck by programmers.
I guess there was some question about learning resources. So do you have some in-depth resources to learn Slate, not by widgets, but in the custom details panel scope?
I don't have as much with that, but let me go to the end here. If you wanted to do custom detail stuff, Alessa's Slate resources are very good for that. You can look at some of the links from there. So I'd recommend checking those out. There's also, you can ask questions on the Discord. Like I have a Discord that people talk about UI stuff specifically. Otherwise, yeah, those are the those places I would start. My website has some stuff, but I haven't done stuff specifically about editors as much as like Alessa and others.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Yeah, and I want just to share with everyone that we'll definitely try to share all the slides and all the useful links from all the speakers later. So we'll put them in the description of the individual videos and in some like follow-up. So yeah, be sure we'll do that.
There's one more question from the audience, from the Redditor. Is double checking, do Slate widgets hold hard reference to the UMG ones that wrap them?
As far as I know, they're not, it's not bidirectional like that. Usually it's kind of tricky to go from Slate up to UMG. Like UMG kind of owns the Slate instance. There are some times where I've definitely wanted to do that myself, of go back up to UMG and poke stuff that way, but I don't think so. I think there's some hacky ways to do it, but no, I don't think so.
Okay, thank you. So I would like to thank Ben for the great and colorful talk here. That was really cool and really very, very interesting. So thank you, Ben, and hope to see you at some other events. Yeah, thank you.
Thanks, Ben. Bye. Have a great one. See ya. Bye.